Right, evening everyone. We'll get started. Fantastic to see all of you here for hopefully it's going to be a challenging and topical debate about enterprise and entrepreneurship. A couple of things not of the fire exit type variety, but two things to note. One, the networking drinks will be after we've finished across in the main area, and someone will direct you over there for those who want to stay for a drink and nibbles. And also, we are proposing, or we are videoing this and recording it as we go through. If people have problems with that, let us know afterwards, and we'll obviously edit it in any way. But that's just to be aware of that. So yeah, so we're thrilled to be hosting this event here at Churchill. The origin of this is a competition that we run most years for students here and recent alumni around new startup businesses. So we have a little competition that concludes with a judging day in all the best ways of these things, and a little bit of prize money and mentoring from alumni to get them started. We've run it a couple of times, and at the end there, David won last year's competition and is actually working through his notice in his proper job, so dives feet first into the whole entrepreneurial world very soon. So we're very excited about that. And one of our alumni is who's on the judging panel as one of his non-execs. So this whole thing started from that, and then we decided to, for this event, sort of as a precursor to launching the next competition, to broaden it out a bit, obviously across the university, and think more about enterprise broadly and entrepreneurship as a, not necessarily have to set up a business to be an entrepreneur, and it's a career, but it's also a career choice that we want to attract as many people into working for small businesses as opposed to KPMG and Goldman Sachs and that lot, because we think startup businesses are an exciting place for graduates to play post-university as well. So a little bit of selfishness. I just very, very quick intro from me. I've sort of spent 20 years or so working SMEs, entrepreneurial technology ventures, building, growing, exiting, building or not exiting, etc. Telecoms, energy, kind of, and software activities. On the panel here, we have Dave, as I've mentioned, Brian Moyo, who's a company that I'm involved in, who will be sponsoring our next round of the competition. So we're very grateful to Brian, who's an entrepreneur in sort of healthcare recruiting. Julie Kilcoyne, next along, Churchill alumni, who's been running an EdTech venture. And Paul Higgins, another Churchill alumni, running a fintech, that sounds kind of sexy, a fintech platform for helping crowd funders do their job. So that's who we've got on the panel. And obviously, we've got Steve Ives, who'll be talking in a second. But before we get going, it's a great honour to be able to invite the Master Professor Dame Matheny Donald to give a few words of intro from a college perspective. Thank you.
Well, I'd certainly like to welcome you all here. I think it's fantastic that Churchill is hosting this event. For those of you who aren't perhaps so familiar with the college, Churchill was founded as the sort of MIT of the UK, very much in Churchill's eyes, with a view to being a place where fantastic new things would come, perhaps concentrating less on the classics and the traditional areas and more on the engineering and STEM. So as a college, we are 70% science, technology, engineering and mathematics in our undergraduate and graduate population. So that gives lots of scope for people to come with that mindset and be enterprising. The thing I like about this title is it focuses on failure, because I think in our society, in our education system, we always stress success. And the reality is, if you're going to be a successful entrepreneur, you're almost certainly going to fall flat on your face from time to time, as I understand it. I have no credentials in this area whatsoever. I'm an academic through and through. But I think we don't really educate in our schools, in our universities, enough about how to cope with failure. And it can be an awful shock if you've been brilliant at school and you come to a place like Cambridge and you suddenly find that everyone else is brilliant and you're not quite as brilliant as they are. And it can be a real shock to the system. And I think whatever you do as you go through life, you are going to have to face up to the fact that it doesn't always go your way and you fail. So I shall be very interested to hear what the panel have to say about that aspect of it, because I think it's fundamental. And unfortunately, I have not got my quotes from Churchill here, but he said something like, every boy and girl should realise that failure will happen and it's all about perseverance. That's not the proper quote, but that's the sort of message, and I think it's right, and therefore, again, it's proper that we should have this debate here in Churchill. So, oh yes, there was one more thing I wanted to say before I wrap up, and that is, if you're interested in economics, if you're worried about the state of our economy post-Brexit, people are constantly talking about the productivity gap, the innovation gap. Why aren't we being successful in the UK? Why are we lagging behind our competitors, wherever they may be? And it seems to me that you here listening to tonight's session should be thinking very much about that, because innovation will come from enterprise. There is no doubt about it. It's not going to rest in the big companies. The big companies are going to do short-term tweaks, but they're not going to be disruptive. And it's really up to the SMEs to be disruptive. So I look forward to an interesting discussion, and then I expect you all to go off and be disruptive, but preferably not in Churchill. Thank you.
Thank you, Master. It's my pleasure to invite Steve Ives to the platform. I think we probably first met 1999. I'd just come back to Cambridge to work for a telecoms consulting company, something around that. And there was a business plan for Trigenix, kind of doing the rounds, and we helped a bit with that. And then you obviously went on to do incredible things in the mobile space and other technology, which I'm not going to go into great detail on, because we'll hear the benefits of that about how not to fail as an entrepreneur.
Yeah, right. Thank you, Simon. Thank you. And you've done a fantastic job in pulling this event together, and I'm delighted to see that the entrepreneurial spirit is alive and well here at Churchill and at the university. Now, when I first came here to Churchill, in fact, first came to this hall, it was 40 years ago. I was a fresh-faced youth of 18, coming up as an undergraduate to do natural sciences. And I remember feeling how smart everybody was in that first term. And it was really hard to get grounded, because I'd been used to being, you know, getting through my exams in pretty good shape when I was at school, but suddenly everybody was super smart, and it really was being thrown in at the deep end. And I came from originally from a state school, and then an assisted school, and it was really, yeah, just diving into some really cold water here at Cambridge. But then you get used to it, and you learn to thrive. Okay, right. So I'm going to talk about, this is like a preamble to, I guess, to what's to come a bit later, thinking like an entrepreneur, because that's how I look at situations. So maybe if I can share a little bit about how I look at things, how I used to look at things, it might be helpful. We might tease out a few insights, or at least a few generalizations, which might be helpful. Okay, so I graduated in natural sciences of my final year in biochemistry, which I haven't really used very much since, I'm ashamed to say. But hopefully I will use a little bit in the future. Then I did a 2-year MBA course at the Wharton School in Philadelphia. And I really didn't learn very much about entrepreneurial activity, I have to confess. It's really a training ground for large enterprise leaders. And but it was paid for, and it was a huge amount of fun, and so it was kind of like a 2-year gap year. And I did learn how to put together a business plan, which was very useful in my first venture, but I wasn't so good at it, so we had to get analysis in to do the business plan for Trigenix. Okay, so my first startup was 1983, so I graduated from Wharton. I'd got a job in consulting in the States. I worked for a strategy firm called Strategic Planning Associates. I was on the first rung of that ladder as a consultant. And I was getting a bit bored and impatient with that, because I guess I'm an entrepreneur at heart, and I had some friends back in Cambridge that were computer scientists. And at Wharton, I'd started to use a device called the IBM PC, and we were using that at SPA for some of the client assignments as well. And this was like the really early days of computing, running Lotus 1-2-3, even before Excel came along. So I was starting to look at PCs, and I had some friends that were really smart computer scientists, and a guy, his name was Steve Jolly. He was very entrepreneurial as well. So we just sat down and we brainstormed what could we build that this market, somebody in this market might want to buy. And we thought, aha, there's going to be a lot more PCs in the world. Than looking from 1983, it was on an exponential curve. At some point, these PCs, which were all standalone, believe it or not, all they would talk to was a printer in 1983 and maybe a hard drive, if you were lucky, an external hard drive. We thought, they're going to need to talk to each other. They're going to need to be networked. So we designed a networking product for office environments. It was called Taurus Icon, the very first product that we built. And in about 5 months or so, we'd put a prototype together, which we thought worked really well. It could give a great demo for about 7 or 8 minutes, and then it would crash. And unfortunately, when a network crashes, it's really hard. You can't just bring up one machine. You've got to kind of bring up the whole network again. But as long as the demo was like 5 minutes, we were okay. But it's such a different world in those days. We went to Barclays Bank. I remember going to Barclays. Walter Heriot was the bank manager. And we managed to borrow £85,000. And I was 25 years old at the time, and I had very little business experience. We had a pretty good business plan. We had a good prototype. We had one or two people that said they might buy the product. And Barclays were prepared to lend us £85,000 unsecured. There was a thing called the government guaranteed loan scheme. And Walter was quite enlightened. And that would never happen these days. Banking has changed out of all recognition. Luckily, we have angel capital now, and that's kind of taken the place of those schemes. But we could do that without giving away any equity. It was a miracle. And just one little story. I'm not going to bore you for too long with all this, but we started to do business with Microsoft, and we had to add some software extensions to DOS, MS-DOS, the operating system, and Microsoft Windows, as it was at the time. And DOS was so primitive, you couldn't even write device drivers without hacking the operating system. So we went to this annual partner event that Microsoft hosted, and Bill Gates was standing on the platform talking about how wonderful the next version of DOS was going to be and previewing Windows. And I bumped into him in the hallway, and I said, Bill, I'm really, really worried about the way things are going with Microsoft, because DOS, it's really primitive. We can't get the access to the APIs that we need. We can't write this networking software without doing those horrendous hacks. We're thinking about switching to Solaris. Sun had this beautiful workstation, an operating system called Solaris. And Solaris does things so much better than Windows. And we're really worried that Solaris is going to dominate the world of personal computing if you don't fix, you know, these really big problems. And I look back on that and I think, how could I have said these terribly stupid things to Bill Gates? That's the only conversation I had with Bill. He kind of apologized for the state of DOS. He said, yeah, it's really pretty bad at the moment, but you're working very hard to improve it. Yeah, he was very gracious. All right, Taurus, that was Taurus. Taurus had a moment in the sun and then it crashed and burned later on. But we did that. We put a fantastic team together. We got the money to build a really good product. And we had the opportunity. The one thing we missed was the graceful exit. A couple of big companies wanted to acquire Taurus in its heyday, 3Com, which was a big networking company, and Microsoft themselves. And if we had sold at that point, there'd be hundreds of millions of dollars of stock. That would have been so wonderful. And I wish it had happened, but it wasn't smart enough to plot that graceful exit. We thought we could go on and conquer the whole world with Taurus. Okay, so fast forward a few years. So Taurus, we were riding a wave of networking and communication that was bound to happen, putting a great team together and just moving as fast as we could, making lots of mistakes, but still we made an incredible headway. Aspective, this was a company that we set up in 99. It was in cloud, before cloud computing existed, enterprise, large companies had systems like customer relationship management systems. They used to have to buy software licenses, install those that software on their own hardware, and do the customization, do the deployment, manage those systems over time. It was terribly expensive and time-consuming for a business to set up a serious system internally. So we started to offer a sort of service over the internet for customer relationship management, and that was Aspective. So that was another wave. We just tried to spot a big wave that we thought was going to come and just position ourselves with one or two early customers and just try and piece together a service that worked for those early customers. And that worked to some extent. In the end, we sold that to Vodafone in about 2006. It was okay as an exit. At least we got an exit. So, and then Trigenix, which was an interesting company. It was a software company based in Cambridge developing mobile user interface framework. Because in 2000, phones had the most terrible, terrible user interfaces. It was the era of the dumb phone, the Nokia phones, before the Nokia smartphones. When Nokia smartphones came along, they had lots of features, but the user interface hadn't really moved forward, so nobody could access those features. So we felt that back in 2000, that if we could create a software layer that made it really easy for manufacturers or mobile operators to create much friendlier, colorful, interesting user interfaces, that would be something worth doing. The iPhone was about, 2005, I think, 2006, the first iPhone, so it's well before that. So Trigenix, again, so we tried to position ourselves for a wave that we thought was going to arrive, and it did arrive. By about 2002, 2003, we had several customers that wanted to use this framework, and we were approached by Qualcomm, who are the biggest mobile semiconductor company in the world, and they wanted a framework like this to graft on top of their chipsets. So they offered to buy Trigenix, and that was a nice acquisition. That was an easy acquisition, because when someone offers to buy you, it's much easier to sort it out. Okay, so that's my sort of some of my story. So I think megatrends, you have to look for the megatrends. These drive the big opportunities for entrepreneurs of the future. If you can spot a megatrend early, and you can position yourself to ride it, and you can assemble a top team of just a few people that can build a product to address some customer needs in the middle of that trend, then you're gonna do okay. The thing is, some megatrends are predictable, and I'll talk about one of those in a second. Some of them are much less predictable, and they just kind of take everybody by surprise. Okay, so the biggest megatrend that I've lived with for my whole working life, pretty much, is Moore's Law. So I guess you all know what Moore's Law is. It's, as Gordon Moore of Intel observed, that the number of transistors that you can etch or manufacture on a square inch of a silicon chip doubles every year at the beginning, and then eventually it got relaxed to it doubles every 2 years. And that relentless progress in the density of transistors and the reduction in price of silicon has driven the 20 years, 30 years or more that we've had of tremendous growth in the computer and the networking industries. However, it's running out of steam. And some people would say, if you look at it from a cost perspective, Moore's Law is pretty much played out already. So the latest Intel microprocessors are running on 14 nanometer geometry on, for example, Broadwell chips that are in the latest Apple laptops. Why are Apple laptops getting so expensive? Because these chips are fearsomely expensive. You can't say, if you're Apple, you can't say to Intel, listen, this is twice as expensive as we want it to be, when Intel have spent billions and billions on the new factories that are needed to make these chips. It's become almost prohibitively expensive to make the transition to each new generation of geometry. So 14 nanometers, there will be at least a couple of more generations of size reduction, but they're going to be very, very expensive chips that come out of those factories. And so you can see that the number of transistors that you're getting for your dollar is actually going down slightly, which is kind of surprising. Most people don't realize that we've kind of reached the peak. And so smartphones aren't going to get a lot cleverer, unfortunately, and laptops are not going to get a lot better because the laws of physics are gating it all. However, looking forward, don't want to be too pessimistic, there's another law called Coomey's law, which is for any given computing load, the amount of battery power you need to drive that those computing operations will fall by a factor of 2 by every year and a half. So this is about power consumption. Okay, so here, if you look at the history of computing, so on the horizontal axis, we have time leading from 1940 to 2010. On the vertical axis, we have computations per kilowatt hour. So these are pretty old computers now, but I suspect if you had your Apple Watch on that, it would fall pretty nicely on that linear relationship. So we're able to do so many more calculations now for any given amount of battery power. And that's going to drive a lot of progress. And that is maybe 15 years from hitting the limits of the laws of physics, 15 years of Coomey's law that all of you still have to find some really exciting business opportunities. So this is going to drive the Internet of Things. So if you look at where we are now, beginning of 2017, we're somewhere between 15 billion connected devices and 28 billion. We're on that curve. And these devices are split between mobile phones, which is currently the biggest segment, which is more than 7 billion. But increasingly, this green segment is going to grow, this non-cellular Internet of Things, which is going to be 14 billion. It's going to be twice as big as the mobile phone segment by 2021. And there's some really exciting startups waiting to be created in this space, because whenever you've got mega growth like this, you've got dozens and dozens of dozens of fantastic business opportunities, if you can find a customer and a use case. Okay, so that's an obvious one, right? So let's just go back. I think Internet of Things is an obvious kind of extrapolation from the internet. It doesn't take a massive creative intellect to figure out that this is going to be a big market. But this one's a bit less obvious, I think. So if you look at the cost of sequencing the human genome, the cost of sequencing DNA, it's been dropping pretty fast, and it was matching Moore's law up until about 07, 08, until a company called Illumina really started to get going on their next generation sequencing technology, which actually came, interestingly, from a Cambridge University invention, a company called Selexa, which was active around about 02, 03, 04. The invention came from Selexa, but Illumina commercialized it and started to drive generations of this technology, and they drove the efficiency so high that the cost per genome has followed this red curve far, far, far better than Moore's law. So this is what I think is perhaps a less obvious opportunity area for you to think about. Age-related disease. So globally, the total healthcare expenses to treat age-related diseases run at over $7 trillion. Sorry, no, read that wrong. The total healthcare expenses around the world for everything is $7 trillion. Half of these expenses are being spent in the last years of life, in 65-plus part of a person's life to help keep them alive for longer. So that's a $3.5 trillion problem that we have very, very few good answers to today. So if you were to ask a doctor, what is the fundamental cause of Parkinson's disease, and is there going to be a cure for Parkinson's disease? Just about every doctor on the planet would say, we don't have a cure and we don't really understand why Parkinson's disease happens. And the same with Alzheimer's, and the same with motor neuron disease, and several other diseases that are more prevalent as you get older. And it costs an enormous amount of money to treat these. So one project that I'm involved with at the moment, which I think is absolutely fascinating, is sequencing the human mitochondrial genome and looking for mutations and polymorphisms and variations in that genome. And you might think, well, that's a very simple thing to do, because the mitochondrial genome is actually very small. It's these little green dots in this picture. The blue is the nucleus of the cell. The red is the mitochondrial complex, all spread out over the cell. The green is the DNA. Each mitochondria has its own little copy it has its own DNA. And mutations arise in this DNA, and they replicate in the cell. And sometimes you'll get a damaging mutation that will spread throughout cells in the entire body and cause a neurodegenerative disease. And this is really on the cutting edge of genomics. It's the mitochondrial genomics, which is really, really a fast-moving area. And these are maps of the human mitochondrial genome. It's a circular genome with a different... there are 13 proteins that are produced from these genes. And in these maps... This is my mitochondrial genome. So it's all white. It means that I basically have identical sequence, the Cambridge reference sequence. I have a normal sequence, except for these four mutations. There's two which have a high frequency, and that's what the long green bars, and two that have a low frequency. So my mitochondria are a mixture of DNA. They contain a mixture of DNA of two different types, one mutated and the other healthy or wild type. So I'm healthy, thank goodness. So I don't have any, hopefully don't have any lurking neurodegenerative disease. This is the map that we call them heteromaps, the map for a Parkinson's patient. So you'll see this one very specific mutation in a gene called ND5, which codes for a protein in complex 1, which is a really crucial enzyme complex in generating energy in your cell, generating ATP. And the data that we have from the very latest experiments very closely links this specific mutation in this specific patient with their Parkinson's disease. And it's very, very exciting what information you can get now. I mean, it's only really possible to do this with the latest generation of technology, getting the sequencing costs so low and using the latest analytical techniques on the data that you get out. So that's another mega trend. It's less obvious because the mitochondrial genome is like a Cinderella area in the research in genomics, because 99% of the scientists are looking at the nuclear genome. This little Cinderella area that nobody's looking at it's got the most amazing potential to solve one of society's big problems. Okay, so to summarize, what I would say to you is to look for and try and ride a megatrend. Yeah? And some megatrends, you will be the first to know, because what you've been working on in the last year or the last few years is right on the cutting edge of that. Some megatrends you can figure out just by reading the news, by being out there in the business world, or many different ways. So try and find and ride a megatrend. So riding a megatrend is finding a few people who've got the technical or engineering skills to build the product that meets a customer need that depends upon that megatrend. Finding those really great people, welding them into a team is crucial. And so run like hell. You have to move so quickly, because everybody is moving fast, and the money is, the big money is being the first or the second exit in the space. Being the third or the fourth or the fifth, the amount of economic value that's there to be had goes down very, very quickly. So the sizzle isn't in the bacon for very long. You have to get the timing right. And that means you need to be pretty early. Okay, build best teams only. So you haven't got time when you're running so fast to do massive surgery on your initial engineering team. So if you haven't got the best three or four people or a really, really talented founding team, you can have all sorts of problems later on trying to recruit people in who you know, you don't know how good people really are until you've worked with them for a while. So you've got to be so discriminating when you're bringing people into that team. And Cambridge companies are well known for interviewing people 10 times. So Cambridge Silicon Radio, that was the great case study, wasn't it? The technical director there was incredibly discriminating about who he would hire. And the Google guys were the same. There were all those stories about the Google interview process. And it's all driven by the realization that doing rework, fixing recruiting errors is incredibly time-consuming and expensive with senior people. So those would be my three key pieces of advice. Also, the exit. I forgot to put that on there, but identifying and negotiating the exit. You can do all those things right, like we did at Taurus. You can forget the graceful exit, and you can lose everything. And that's pretty tragic if you work for 5 or 6 years and then you haven't got anything to show for it. So those would be my few insights or generalizations or whatever you want to call them, on how to think like an entrepreneur.
Fantastic.
Okay.
More than a couple of interesting themes in there, but reinforcing the fact that entrepreneurial startups are as dependent on getting quality people in as anybody else kind of reinforces one of those messages. And I guess as an economist, one of the things I've had a huge amount of admiration for entrepreneurs from science engineering background is their incredible grasp of the content and the way things are going to change, and they can disrupt that. And so many of the successful entrepreneurs have this insight into the way that things work and that content depth, if you haven't got it. I see that as a real struggle of how to engage with customer needs when you haven't got that genuine insight into what's going to make a difference. So fascinating. Thank you, Steve. I just invite the rest of the panel just to give 2 or 3 minutes of a bit of insight from their experience as entrepreneurs, the good bits, and maybe one or two of the not so good bit. Paul, could you want to kick us off?
Yeah. am I okay here?
I think the microphones kind of follow us.
Okay, great. I was at Churchill 2000. I left in 2006. I did computer science here, and then worked for small business for about 5 years or so, and then started a company, as Simon said, in fintech, financial technology. So my company, Crowd Valley, is a software company that sort of powers crowdfunding platforms and peer-to-peer lending platforms around the world. And so we've been going about 6 years now, and we've got about 30 people in the team, and there have been lots and lots of highs and lots of lows. I think one of the things from my experience that really stands out is just how long everything takes. A startup, in a sense, is a long, long list of tasks, of thousands and thousands or millions of tasks, and you're sort of on your own and you don't have anyone else to do those for you, so that you have to do everything. And the list of tasks is very fuzzy. You don't really know whether you're going in the right direction or not. And so what that means is you sort of have to give yourself enough time to fail, in that sense, failing in the sense of going in the wrong direction, of doing tasks that don't lead to where you think they might lead, for example. And a big part of being an entrepreneur is handling your own sort of personal finances, in the sense of just making sure you have enough time personally to stick at it for as long as you're interested. I think a lot of people start a business whilst also working for another another company, for example, so that they still have some salary coming in. And that seems to be frowned upon in some areas, but I think that's wrong that it's frowned upon. I think if it's something that gives you enough time to get through those ups and downs, then that can be quite important. And at some point, you'll, of course, be ready to step off and do it full time. And then at that point, again, you need to give yourself the longest runway, in a sense, possible. And I think a lot of people have this concept from reading startup press or technology press that the answer to that is venture capital or angel investment. And my company never took any investment. We never had any external funding. And we managed to make that work by putting all of the energy that we would do into that, into finding customers that would pay us to do anything that we would, that we could. So we were building crowdfunding platforms for people, and they would say, can you give us some marketing advice? Can you do some designs for us? Can you do this and that? Can you introduce us to people? And so that's obviously not what the business was all about, but it was a way to allow us to keep going and give ourselves enough time to get through. I think some of the most challenging parts actually are nothing to do with the business itself, but it's the personal side. It's the fact that you don't really feel like going on holiday for a long time, and if you're with friends that you go on holiday with, or you're with a partner, then that can be quite tough. I remember one thing I did go to, which was a close friend's stag weekend in Europe about 3 months after I went full time, and I discovered, having got there, that I was in a group of about 15 bankers and consultants and accountants, and they had no problems of buying a round for 15 people for 100 euros or something, and I had to sit there and avoid buying a round for the whole weekend. And actually, I've never admitted that to anyone before. If you're watching, Mike, I'm sorry about that. But so, as the master said earlier, you tell yourself a certain story about the kind of person you are if you get to Cambridge, and you tell yourself a story that you're doing fine, you're doing well, and then you have to suffer through these moments where it sort of hits you a little bit more. So those are the bad sides of it, but if you manage to make it work, it is pretty awesome. We have 30 people now that we employ who are great fun to work with, and we have lots of customers who wouldn't be able to do their business without our technology, and that feels fantastic. And so despite the bad things, it's worth giving it a go.
Thank you, Paul. Julie.
I actually have quite a lot in common, I think, with what actually Paul's just said. So I graduated from Churchill in 94 as a geographer. Not many geographers in Churchill. I was one of them. And went into teaching, mainly because I didn't really know what else to do. And it's a sort of family business. So I went into teaching and actually really loved it. And that was fantastic, but knew it wasn't going to be forever. So I was looking for something to do and to start. And had a friend at Churchill and who was in corporate finance, and we decided to start a business together. And we thought it was really important to do something that we knew a lot about and that we loved. So we tried to open a bar, and that wasn't a good idea at all, actually, because we clearly didn't know anything about the hospitality industry. So we decided in the end to go into EdTech, and we were, I think, incredibly lucky, actually. We didn't get financing. We did go to the bank, but they didn't give us a loan. So we raised a little bit of money ourselves, 15,000 each, and we started producing digital content for schools, which probably was a mega trend. I don't think we realised that at the time, but it was. And I think the problem that we had is that we were growing organically and by sales, and we had to support ourselves and our employees. So we would take sort of commissions from people. We've translated all our content into Welsh. That's not an easy thing to do. And probably wasn't the right thing to do at the time, because it slowed actually our growth. We kept going, but it slowed our growth, in hindsight. So I think it's great to be able to finance your own company. You own 100% of it. That's great if you do exit. It's hard, though, to keep on going. And sometimes I think you maybe take commissions and projects that you shouldn't really take. I think one bit of advice I would give, certainly from EdTech, you probably don't have to run quite so fast. I actually don't think the industry moves on quite so quickly. So we were quite lucky. We were one of the first entrants in the market, but the big players, Pearson, OUP, weren't that quick off the mark, actually. So it gave us a bit of time to develop our assessment platform, which is what we do now. One bit of advice which really resonates with what people have said, is to get a fantastic team around you. I think when you're a startup, it's how to encourage those great people to work with you. So it's about maybe selling the vision, about encouraging them, incentivizing them. So that was, I think, a really key part. And we still spend, I would have thought, about 10% of our time recruiting and keeping growing the team. So I think that's a really key thing. I think the other thing is that as you grow your company, you should really understand what each sector does. You know, if you've got a development team and you know nothing about coding, but you've got to manage that team, that development manager, I think you have to get stuck in. Same with sales. You have to understand what each of your teams does, and ideally be able to do it to some extent, or at least to ask the right questions. That's what I'd say.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Brian, if you're alive, then this is our healthcare representative.
I think I'm the only one on this panel who is not from Cambridge University. Our company is sponsoring, so I bought my way onto this panel. But
I just think you were invited, but anyway.
Yeah, but I run a recruitment business, healthcare recruitment, and my background is healthcare. I'm a qualified psychiatric nurse. So again, like Julie, my advice is do something that you know about. And I think that's what every entrepreneur will try and advise you. Do something that you know about. The reason we started the business with my business partners, and one of them is here, is to learn business, basically. It wasn't this amazing idea that, oh, we've discovered something, we've created an innovative product. No. Healthcare recruitment, there's so many healthcare recruitment companies out there. We thought, we've always wanted to do business. What can we do that's easy to start, that's not capital intensive, that we can learn from and move on to bigger and better things? So that's the reason why we started. 3 years down the line, we're still doing it, we're still learning. Learning never ends, to be honest. One of the things we learned the hard way is that our turnover looked great, our numbers looked great, but profit-wise, there wasn't much money there. And we didn't have that experience, so we got our pricing strategies wrong. Thank God we've got Simon now to help us with that. He's on our board, he's the chairman of our board, so is helping us with that. Team as well, we're friends. 3 of us started the business as friends. So again, it's not a high-tech, innovative business, so it was quite easy to start off with friends. There were a lot of disagreements, a lot of problems in meetings, but when we got external entities like Simon to come on, it stabilized the team, because then we could have an objective person without any emotional attachment in the business. So, yeah, your team can be, these guys are as experienced in healthcare as I am, and they had different experiences, so we all brought something different to the business. So your team is as good, your business is as good as your team, and your team doesn't have to be a specific type of team. Each business is different. Why do you start the business in the first place would determine as well what kind of team you have and where you want to go with your business. But other than that, I mean, if you want to start a business, just start. That's what we did. I think when we started the business, it was less than £1,000 that we started the business with. Turnover is in excess of £1 million now, but it's a high cash flow intensive business, but not high capital intensive. So use other people's money, basically. That's what we do. Yeah, so yeah, I think that's our story. And this was actually my second venture, business venture. I've always had that entrepreneurial itch. First business I did was IT related. We basically identified that in Africa, in Malawi in particular, there was a lot of NGO funds out there. So there was one or two IT companies that basically charged what they wanted because the funds were donor funds. They didn't care. If you charge them £800 for a laptop that cost £300, they didn't care because it wasn't their money. Sorry to say that, but this is how some administrations, whether NGOs or governments, treat or used to treat donor funds. So we identified that, and we were buying computers from Dell, sending them there, selling them for double at least. But the business didn't succeed because we didn't have the funds to put up the money up front. Someone would order 80, 100 computers, £20,000. We didn't have that kind of money up front, and they wouldn't pay until you delivered. So the lesson we learned there was, was get your funding and financing correct, and everything else will kind of fall into place. But start. Just start, even if your idea is not fully fledged. You don't have the perfect business plan. Who says it's not the perfect? Well, unless you're asking for someone else's funds, the bank might tell you that your business plan is not good enough. But if you're not asking for anyone else's money and you're starting off with a little bit, prove that you can do it with £1,000. The bank will lend you the rest of it, or your family or friends or whichever way you want to do it. But just start. That's the only way you can find out whether you can do it or not.
Fabulous. Thank you, Brian. Thank you for the promotion. Dave, early days, but
yeah,
you're
exactly.
Suffering some of these issues.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm very much early stages of being an entrepreneur. I don't have the £1 million revenue or any massive exits like that. But I'm giving it a go at the moment as an entrepreneur with a company called Biotexpert. And I've recently, as I mentioned, just left my full-time job to risk it with Biotexpert and see if I can make a go of it and get enough funding to allow me to continue doing that for a few more years, and then seeing where that'll take it in terms of exit or growing a sustainable business. And so just to give a little bit of background to that, so I applied for the Churchill competition last year. That's probably pretty much the start of the company Biotexpert, actually. And we won that competition, which was really which is a real boost for us, and sort of gave us like some initial feedback and validation on the idea, and gave me and Graham sort of confidence and a little bit of cash as well. The £1,000 was really helpful to pursue it a bit further, and it put us in touch with some really useful mentors as well. Valerie, who's a non-executive director, and Simon obviously has provided us quite a bit of advice over the time as well, and Meredith, who's here as well, who we've provided a lot of constructive feedback on the development of our products. So that was about a year ago, and we've got a little bit of funding since then. We've launched a website, biotexpert.com. We've got some customers. And we're just at the stage of trying to get some partnerships together that will hopefully prove that provide the demonstration of the market need that we'll be able to raise a bigger round of funding. So I'll just move on to a few of the little things I've picked up over the year. So first of all, to the Churchill Enterprise Competition, I'd really recommend that to anyone who is thinking of applying for the reasons I sort of outlined. Because I actually applied for it the year before as well with a company called Abdicare, and that got quite negative feedback, and that led us to drop that idea and move on to Biotexpert. So it was, you know, whether you succeed or not in that competition, it's very, very useful. And then when I was sort of scribbling down some of the things that I've learned over the last year, they sort of fell into four categories. One was about having the right idea and the right product development. The second category was about the right getting the right people involved, and that's what everyone has been saying as well. And then also the right organisation and the right money. So then just going in a tiny bit more detail on those. In terms of the right idea, I think, yeah, it does take us longer than we thought it might to like really shape the idea. You know, we thought we had a good idea at the start, but then you start speaking to customers and people who actually would use the product, and you realise actually that's not what they want at all. And because we had a call with a venture capital firm where we said we can put you in touch with this massive group of postdoc academics, and we said, you know, wouldn't this be really interesting for you for due diligence purposes and everything? And the feedback we got from that was they wanted to actually speak to the top specialists in particular fields, and just being a postdoc wasn't enough. So anyway, that helped us shape our product offering to that particular customer. And then I think thinking about whether the potential final revenue is enough to justify the costs and the sacrifices that you're going to have to put in the first place is a pretty important starting point. Because when we had this great idea about a freelancing consultancy platform where you could call an expert in a particular field within biotech, and then when we looked at the numbers of how many calls we'd need to get through the platform at our commission rate to get enough to cover all the costs involved, that wasn't it didn't add up. So it wasn't worth taking a risk on. So we've had to expand our the different services that we offer and look to more corporate contracts. So then the third area was the right people. For me, it's like the right co-founder and having a really productive relationship there, and being complementary, like different but complementary in our approaches and our perspectives. Then the right mentors, that and being able to get the right mentors involved, I think, is a good sign that there's something to your idea. If you're trying to get mentors involved and they're just not really sort of giving you time, then it's probably have to kind of think about why that might be, or and vice versa. If they are, then it's a good indication. And then putting that into the board, I think it's been really helpful for us, getting a good balance of different expertise and experience on our board. And then, finally, the right organisation, I think, has been pretty key in terms of, as Paul was saying, like, I've just got a massive list of tasks, and having them well sort of organised to kind of just work through them on massive spreadsheets, and using all the software that's available out there for organising your tasks, organising your accounts, organising like company secretarial stuff, has also been pretty helpful. So that was a few things I want to say.
Perfect, and best of luck.
Cheers, thank you.
Going forward, and I think we've learnt a new tagline for the competition next year, is how to turn £1,000 into £1 million turnover. So no surprise, Brian's sponsoring with £1,000. So that's our new mantra. So I think just a number of themes coming through that, and from my experience where I've seen ventures fail. So even if the entrepreneur has this belief in the customer problem, or they've got the right belief in the customer problem that they're trying to solve, they either give up too soon. Actually balancing that with Steve's point about mega trends, the door's not open for that long, so you better be the first at it, or third, or whatever. But they give up too soon, or take too long to learn some basics and not taking advice from those who've actually been there before, and just make it easy for yourself by not wasting time having to learn stuff that's the obvious, which isn't going to be the key to success, because there are people around to help. I think that's come through. And also, there's not been much about investors. Most of the businesses I'm involved in, unfortunately or fortunately, have had to go for external investment, whether it's startup or follow-on. And some have crashed and burned once they've got the investors involved, because the dynamic hasn't been quite right. They've either you know, brought on the wrong type of investors, or they forgot that investors do have emotions as well. It's not just about hard cash, and they do need their investors to support them later in various ways. Unless they bring that on as well as the customers, they can fall flat on their feet, unfortunately. Great. So I know time's getting on. It's not quite 7 o'clock yet, so we're not doing too bad. Open up to the floor, really. Any questions? I think we have Annabelle with the roving microphone and Jennifer. Excellent. Jeremy Kyle style. Any questions from the floor? Please. Harry, you're the first up. There's a couple on either side to follow. These folks, not me, obviously.
Is this on? Yeah. Obviously, running an early stage company is a very busy and time-consuming activity, but you've also talked about the need to kind of think about what you're doing and kill ideas that aren't working. How do you, you know, day-to-day or week-to-week, make the headspace to actually reflect on what you're doing and why, and choose not what not to do, just as much as you're choosing what you can do?
Who wants to have a go at that first? Steve, do you want to?
Is the microphone working? Yeah.
Yeah,
this is the hardest thing, knowing when to kill one of your babies that's consuming a lot of resources and not making a lot of progress. It's the hardest thing. I mean, when you're an entrepreneur, you're always thinking about work, unfortunately, for your spouse or partner. You're kind of always tending to think about things when you're outside of work. And yeah, it's really hard to make those kind of decisions in the 9-to-6 environment. So you have to make them in the shower or the bath or somewhere or on holiday. And I don't think entrepreneurs do get those things right all the time. I mean, Steve Jobs has invested in a lot of really bad projects in his time as well. He killed way too late. So I think I don't have any hard and fast rules. I mean, you can measure how much you're spending on this particular product relative to its revenue, but often you need to overcome a particular barrier before it's going to sell, and it's so easy to give up just before it takes off. So it's tough.
Anyone else want to respond to that?
It's a very good question, and I
probably don't have a good answer for it either, but I think one of the difficulties is that it's very easy to have a sense of progress which ends up in the wrong direction, and you can easily convince yourself that something is going well, and then discover that actually that was the wrong path. And I think in the end it's a kind of gut feeling. I don't have any sort of system for it. I think you just have to talk it through with people you trust in the team and see what the general feeling is and then act on that.
So we go on. Yep.
Sorry, just to add to that, I think it took us 5 years, myself and the other co-founder, to have a regular weekly meeting, and we've kept that up now for last 10 years, and that's made a massive difference. Actually, having a bit of time. And the other thing that we tend to do, it's probably different in different industries, is get the product to market without it being perfect. So we try and sell at least the concept to people quite early on.
So in one of my ventures, we've just taken on a non-exec from Visa. And she is taking us through one aspect of their strategic planning process, which is this stop, start, continue matrix, which from an entrepreneurial venture is proving the most tortuous and painful exercise that we've ever done. So we do have a list of things to stop. I'm not sure we ever will. So the answer to this appears to be that these start things need to be far more exciting and inspiring than the things that are on the list to stop, and then we have a chance of time being spent on the newer things, and these other things might drift. That's a very unsatisfactory answer, but this is work in progress. I'll let you know how that goes, but the chance of actually stopping something, I'm very excited if we actually do. Any other comments?
Sometimes your investors force you to stop because you've put so much money and effort into a particular product, and if you've got external investors, you're having board meetings every month, and they're adding up the numbers, and so you're continually having to defend your projects, and the facts stack up eventually, and you know they can stack up pretty overwhelmingly against a project. So it's kind of negotiation as well.
Great. We had two other hands, and there's I think lady in the red under the brown cardigan.
Hi, I'm Shima Baraka from the Judge Business School. I was wondering what role entrepreneurship education played or wish you had played in this formula, whether, you know, it fed into anything, it was meaningful, you know. Have you had entrepreneurship education or wish you'd had?
You know, when I was
a student here, I didn't really know what entrepreneurship was, to be honest. I had the sense that my career choices leaving Cambridge were fairly limited to a consultant or a bank or a law firm or an accounting firm. And we were talking earlier with some of the other panelists that I think those companies spend so much on recruiting, on advertising for trying to recruit students that small business doesn't really get a look in so much. So my experience was working with a kind of small consulting firm that supported startups, tech startups, and so I sort of learned on the job entirely. But I think I would have liked to have known more about what entrepreneurship was at an earlier stage.
Interesting. I did my Wharton MBA about 10 years or so after Steve, and then there was I majored in entrepreneurial management. So at the time, and they were real entrepreneurs doing those parts of the courses, and a number of us almost got to buy businesses or set things up in the States before we got a bit worried about the legal context of doing anything in the US. But I think there were started to get real practical, not just be a Wall Street banker, but how to do interesting things beyond that that started to improve. And for me, it took me 10 years after that probably to get involved in entrepreneurial activity, but that was pretty vital for me because I'm not the ideas person.
I think it's really hard to learn to be an entrepreneur by going to business school. I mean, because it's such a practical set of skills that you need, and a classroom environment, the teaching paradigm at business school is not well suited to teaching you the skills that you need to succeed in real world of business. I mean, I hate, because I got an MBA, so it sounds weird when I say this. You know, I should be extolling the virtues of executive education. But my first business experience was when I was 5 years old. My brother and I hosted a puppet show in our garage, and we sold tickets for, I think it was like sixpence each. And borrowed a whole lot of biscuits and orange squash out of the cupboard. So it was all funded by my parents, unbeknownst to them. And they were horrified when they found that we sold all these tickets to like 60 kids around the neighborhood. And we kind of got told off a little bit, but not too badly, thank goodness.
So kind of I can just add to that I was going to take an MBA, but we actually started the business instead. So I didn't go to London Business School. I think what we would have learned is that certainly for the first 10 years, we were very inward-looking as a company. So we grew, we made money, which is a good thing. We're in 85% of secondary schools, our products, but nobody knew us in the industry because we hadn't realised at the time. And I think going to business school or thinking about networking a little bit, that would have helped us. We didn't realise that the PR is an important and making contacts and networks. So it's only really when we set up a business in America and people in EdTech in America are a lot more open than they were here, that we realised not only it was going to be good for the company and we'd attract better people, but we'd also be able to talk through ideas with similar thinking people. So I think I would have learned that a bit quicker.
Yeah, just a follow-up. I think her question related to studying entrepreneurship more than business administration, which is an MBA. And I mean, I don't mean to pick on any of you, but I think there's a difference. And to be honest, I've never met an entrepreneur that has studied entrepreneurship. I think it's a different background. Have you met an entrepreneur who has studied entrepreneurship, or because they're two different things, right? MBA and entrepreneurship. Is that correct?
They are completely different things, yes. And I don't think I've ever met an entrepreneur who studied entrepreneurship. Yeah.
And I think we were having that conversation. To say, can you teach someone to be an entrepreneur, or is it something that they have within them? I don't think we came to a conclusion, but I think you're just born with that itch. You know, you want to go into to get formal education is maybe just formalizing that and directing your thinking and maybe showing you whether you're an entrepreneur or not, but it doesn't necessarily make you one, I don't think.
Yeah, I've got examples probably of people who are entrepreneurs in their before, they just did that as the route to do it rather than, yeah, then you convert them into it. Yeah, it's interesting question. We have somebody else with a microphone.
Hello, Sinjin.
I think it happens automatically.
Hello, Sinjin Piano from Abakai. A very boring question. I was wondering if any of you had any thoughts on just handling the nuts and bolts, for example, bookkeeping software or accounting, that sort of thing.
Your favourite accountancy packages, folks.
very briefly, what we've just set up, which has been really helpful, is Xero. That's like the standard accounting one, I think, has been really, really helpful. And also a company secretarial one for handling shareholders' certificates and all the... It sort of syncs up with Companies House. I think it's called Inform Direct, and that was free, and that's been really, really useful as well. And in general, I really like quite using... Because there's so much free software out there that you can make use of. Me and my co-founder and the other people in the team, we all use like WhatsApp and Skype and Jitsi and things for just like constant communication, and Slack obviously is quite a popular one as well. Google Drive, obviously. So that's the few things I've got to say on that.
I use a system called Free Agent for accounting, and I'm actually also an investor in it because it was a crowdfunding campaign on Cedars about 4 years ago or 3 years ago, and I put in about £50, Free Agent was actually one of the first companies to exit after a crowdfunding platform because it's now listed on the AIM stock market after about 3 months ago. So my £50 is now worth at least 100, and that's probably the best investment I'll ever make.
I hear great things about Xero all the time, so yeah, I don't think you could go wrong with that.
And I think there's also two parts of your question, wasn't there, accounting and bookkeeping? So Xero deals with accounting, but then lots of entrepreneurs I've had keep hold of bookkeeping, which is not really what they're an entrepreneur to do. So you try and get them to do things, and they're spending their time inside the account system as opposed to getting out to customers and things. So think about delegation or offloading bookkeeping swiftly, and the packages help, but it doesn't answer that problem. Okay. Lady at the front here.
My interest is marketing, so I have a cheeky question. I would like to know how you got your customers, because I know digital technology has enabled many startups to enter markets. So,
how did you get your customers? It's a great question, actually.
When we started with the networks of people that we knew, because we're coming from healthcare, so went back to our previous companies, other companies that we knew about, just our personal networks. That's where our first customers came from. Then after that, get a sales team to do the rest.
We started with trade shows. At the time, they were pretty good. And our market in the UK was so small, it's only 3,500 secondary schools, and we went school to school. So that probably doesn't help with the marketing question, but that's what we did initially.
for us, we were sort of involved in the crowdfunding sector so long ago. I mean, really, when it was just starting. So back then, 2009, 2010, there weren't that many people writing about crowdfunding online. And so we started a blog, and we've written a blog article a week for 6 years about the fintech sector and crowdfunding, and that has a huge influence. And so the majority of our customers come to us now.
Some markets you can reach directly, and you can pull together a list of your ideal customers. You can hire one or more really good salespeople, go contact them directly. I mean, that's a kind of logical way, but sometimes you have to go indirectly and you have to build a channel to market. And so that's one thing I would think about early on is, do you need a channel? Because sometimes it's not possible or practical to go direct all the time. So that's a different kind of marketing for the channel. Yeah.
So just on your trend of riding a mega trend, one of the big reasons you hear from entrepreneurial ventures failing is, we were ahead of our customers. They didn't get what we were doing. So trying to get, it's partially educating the customer as well as...
Yeah. You have to speak directly to early customers in the beginning, otherwise you don't get to understand in enough detail what they really need. But the channel's great to speak to as well, if there is a channel model, because they speak to customers all the time. They speak to 50 or 100 customers, and they can give you a lot faster insights.
Okay. Yeah, so at the front. Yeah.
Thanks. Meredith Lloyd Evans, independent business consultant and mentor, and I think hopefully entrepreneurial in the way I think about things. But you know, I've been quite interested here. We've got four people who are very close to the market, who don't appear to have been like some of the people I meet who have started with a research idea and they've got a technology or scientific concept that they are desperately sure is going to be riding that mega trend or whatever. So what? And also another couple of questions, another couple of comments here. I think you said, Julie, that you're quite happy to go to the market with something that's not perfect. There's another point here about that you were saying, Simon, about some entrepreneurs failing because they say we were ahead of the trend or ahead of the needs. So there's an awful lot of flexibility that's required there to be able to understand what the target customers want. And that balance between trying to sensitize them to new technologies that might help them get further. What do you think? I'm interested in your comments about this situation where do we need to divide people into inventors, innovators, and entrepreneurs? In the sense that the inventor is the one who has the spark of genius of the idea. It doesn't need to be scientific. It could be a business service idea. The innovator is the one who can see the way to, like, kind of reduce it to practice. And the entrepreneur is the one who genuinely has this deep desire to make the business from it, to influence the market and to get things done. Should we separate those, or should we see them as a continuum? Should we try and, when we're building a team, actually try and get those fragments of different people together into a team even if they're not represented by individuals?
So hard to generalize, isn't it? I mean, you look at Dyson, for example. I mean, Dyson is an inventor, an innovator, and an entrepreneur. And that's unusual, I think, to combine them all into one person, but it's not incredibly unusual. I think but your point is well made. Usually, those are different skills, and if you want world-class people in each, you would find a different person and meld them into a team. But on the other hand, some people are incredibly talented and can combine them at least for a while. Or at least I think they're probably extremely good at delegating, which is the key, isn't it? Finding great people you can trust and then delegate.
Any other comments on that? Should we go? I'm way over our time, Contra. Thank you for your patience here. We have one more. If there is one more question, please, and then we'll draw a line on it. Thank you.
Very quick, I hope. Most of you have or have had staff. So if you had to say one thing you would have liked to have known when you hired someone, what would that be?
Don't all shout at once.
How long are they going to stay with you? If I could know that before I hired them, that would be great.
I think it probably depends on exactly who I'd be taking on. So in sales, you might be looking for somebody who is really persistent and really wants the sale. Obviously professional, but they are really motivated by getting the sale. While I wouldn't necessarily look for that same trait in an editor that we might take on. So I think it does vary.
We have a rather unusual recruitment policy because we're a sort of diverse team around the world, and working in technology, everyone works from wherever they want to work. We don't have a single fixed office where everyone works from. And so we took that opportunity to say, we're probably not going to be very good at interviewing for quite a long time, and we're not going to fly everyone around the world to do an interview. So we will allow people to work with us for a short period, like a couple of months, for 5 hours a week or 10 hours a week, and we'll see how that works out. And if they like it and we like it, then we carry on and we just keep increasing the amount of time they spend with us. So we've never really done interviews, and it wasn't my idea. It was kind of crazy at the beginning, but it's worked out quite well for us. So that's how we've approached that issue.
Yeah, and that's a really good answer, because, I mean, it's great to avoid the problem in the first place by testing people out for extended periods. The other thing to be really cautious of is getting entrapped in an employment contract with somebody. This usually goes for senior people. Getting trapped into an employment contract that's so expensive to terminate from your side if things don't go well. And I can think of several instances where we were kind of negotiated into that situation and then had to pay out 100K plus to exit that person at some point in the future. Mm. So, yeah, I think that's a really smart move. I like that.
Yeah, and I think work ethic is just a bigger heading. I get hear a lot on entrepreneurs do not understand why people don't work the same way as they do and have the same priorities. And the simple fact is they're the entrepreneur and they're not. So bits about the attitude and work ethic, I think, can help. Fabulous. Well, thank you very much.